traditional owners of this country, the Darawal people, and the local land, the Wollongong people. And I'd also like to continue our respect and deep respect for the elders past, present, and to the future, and also the guidance in our hearts. And we'll be able to show you today.
And I have the great pleasure of introducing Mel Ritchie, our Vice President, and her guest, Indy Marks.
Thank you for coming today, everybody. A nice big crowd. My name is Melissa Ritchie, and as Susan mentioned, I'm the Vice President of IAVA, and I've invited the lovely Indy Mark here to speak, who I met at the Archibald last year when we were voting for the finalists. India and I have got to know each other over the last couple of weeks. We're very different and our parts have been very different, but we have a lot of parallels and I'm very looking forward to showing you what they are today. So welcome, India Mark.
So today, both Melissa and myself will be talking about our separate painting practices, successes and how our lives have led us to painting today. Melissa and I met just under a year ago at a luncheon for the Archibald Prize in 2016, and obviously our love of portraiture both led us there. Alright, so I'll talk about my Archibald finalist portrait of local singer-songwriter Dane Taylor later on in this presentation, but first I'd like to tell you a bit about who I am, where I grew up, and what led me to want to study and pursue a career in painting. So, I've got some very early drawings to share with you today, at the courtesy of my mum, Maria, who documented all of my childhood drawings in a cookbook, several of them. So this is a very early self-portrait that I did in 1999 when I was five. And it basically is a picture of me in a flower dress and with a blow-up ball that had like one of those sky dances on it. I don't know if anyone remembers what sky dances were, but they were like Barbies with wings on their arms that sort of flew in their hair. These are some other very early drawings from 1998. So I grew up in Jerrigum with my mum, dad and my brother next to the ocean, and I think growing up by the ocean really influenced my drawings. I have very vivid memories of drawing when I was a child. I spent hours and hours drawing, mostly mermaids and ballerinas. I guess lots of women and girls in fancy clothes, experiencing all kinds of things like love and friendship. This is a portrait that I did of my kindergarten class. It's got every single member of the class with their initials underneath it. And this is an early collaboration with my little brother. The black drawing is what I've done, and the blue drawing is what he's done a couple of years later. So I did the mermaids and the dolphins, and he did the merman with the nipple tassels and the shark. And this one's a later drawing, a later collaboration that my brother has found, and he's written the speech bubble that says, "Where are my arms, my foe?" I started painting in watercolours when I was about 10 or 11, and I became obsessed with drawing and painting tiny, intricate, little detailed things. Which kind of epitomized in my year 12 major work. I was obsessed with the 18th century decorative and fine arts genre, the Rococo. And my major work for Year 12 was all about King Louis XV's favourite mistress, Madame de Pompadour, who was a pretty spectacular woman for her time. She was a huge influence on how decorative arts became a part of the French lifestyle in the 18th century. And she pretty much decorated the entire Palace of Versailles and supported a lot of the artists who become signature of that time, such as François Boucher and Jean-Baptiste Simon Chardin as well. So this watercolour series of five was accepted into Art Express in 2012, and I think it was at this point that I started to really consider pursuing painting beyond high school level. I didn't really consider pursuing a tertiary education in visual art until year 12, because I wasn't sure if you could develop a proper career. I realised that making a living from painting is very hard, and that hasn't really changed, but I thought I would take the plunge, and in 2012 I started studying at the India School of Art, and also coincided with getting a haircut, which is, pretty mandatory. I studied at AU School of Art from 2012 until halfway through 2013. I actually transferred to the National Art School and completed my undergraduate degree in 2015. But the education that I received at AU School of Art has been a pretty fundamental aspect of how I paint today. From the very beginning at AU, we were sort of ingrained with very traditional painting techniques. We started painting in oils from the very first day. I think our first lesson was how to make rabbit skin gesso from scratch, which is what they used back in the Renaissance to prime all of their supports before they started painting. We also learned how to make our own egg temperas and oil paints, which I don't do now, but maybe one day. We also spent a huge amount of time life painting. So for the first 2 months of second year painting at ANU, we were doing 40 hours of life painting a week. So 8 hours a day, every day a week, painting from a life model. It was pretty amazing and intense, and a bit boring at times, but definitely so, like such an important part of my art education that I've received so far. We learned how to paint tonally during this time, so with oil painting, creating a tonal underpainting as the base of your work has been something that I've continued in my work today, and these are very early examples from that time. We also did a lot of transcriptions, so where we copied famous paintings. So these are my transcriptions of a Picasso self-portrait, two Van Gogh self-portraits, and a portrait by Velazquez. And it was also during this time that we started investigating portraiture as well. This is a very early portrait that I did of my friend Georgia, who is on the right here with me. That was a photo taken at the time. I didn't really paint or draw observationally before I went to art school. That was something that didn't really occur to me. Whereas it's such an important part of figurative and representational painting. But all throughout my childhood and adolescence, I basically used drawing and painting as a way to express things that I lived out in my imagination, rather than, drawing a still life or painting a portrait of someone. And that's kind of continued into my work a little bit now, which kind of leads body of work that I'm completing for my Master of Fine Art at National Art School. I'm in the second year of my Master's this year, and my final year. So the subject matter of my MFA is on trainees, and I'm actually going to read this bit out. I want to make it clear. So my Master of Fine Arts research area of study is on trainees, which is, I'll explain what it is now. So a trainee is a genre of figurative painting that originated in the Netherlands during the 17th century, which is often referred to as the golden age of Dutch painting. The old Dutch word training translates into head or face, and the genre itself was predominantly developed by the two artist friends, Rembrandt and Jan Leavens, as a way of selling small, affordable figurative works directly from their studio to dealers, collectors, and buyers. The typical training is small in scale and features a bust-length figure that has either been painted from life or based on studies, drawings, paintings, and in some cases, the artist's own imagination. So trainees are not to be mistaken for portraits. Unlike portraits, trainees don't aim to depict an individual by capturing a likeness. The identity of the model is irrelevant and unnecessary, which liberated the artist to experiment with exaggerated lighting, costume, facial expression, and painterly technique. Confusingly, however, a self-portrait can be considered a trainee. Back in the 17th century, there was no such thing as a self-portrait. Self-portraiting didn't become a thing until the mid-19th century. So a lot of Rembrandt's most, famous works are actually considered trainees. They think that around 25% of all of Rembrandt's paintings were actually trainees. And what makes it even more confusing, probably should have included an example in my slideshow, but a lot of Rembrandt's self-portraits weren't actually painted by him. They were painted by his students, I guess, as transcriptions, as ways of learning how to paint and how to capture light and flesh tones. And, it's a fun fact. If you're still wondering what a trainee is and think that you've never seen one before, I think you might be wrong, because this is the most famous trainee, Jan Vermeer's Girl with a Pearl Earring, which was painted in 1660 to around 1670. It's perhaps one of the most famous examples of a trainee, particularly because it's a small painting. It's only 46 by 45 by 40 centimeters. It's a bust-length portrait, so it's only her head and shoulders, and she's also wearing fancy dress costume. So the clothes that she's wearing, particularly the headdress, weren't standard sort of Dutch everyday clothes. And the pearl earring is considered a vanitas motif in this painting. So vanitas paintings were paintings that kind of illuminated human mortality in contrast with the beautiful things that people acquired during their lifetime, so jewelry, instruments, art, things of material sort of status that we value and would eventually outlive us. So a vanitas painting with a person in it usually features a young person, so rather than an old person. This is, I guess, to sort of further illuminate the sad tragedy that we're going to die. So these are my examples of trainees. I loosely base my training painting practice on the painting practices of Rembrandt and Jan Leavens, but I don't paint from life like they would have. I also don't paint from my imagination. I usually use photos that I find in magazines and online catalogs and stuff. So this is an example. And I also don't base them, I base them loosely on the photographs. I'm not really preoccupied with, you know, totally depicting an accurate copy of the person. And I also find that when I'm painting, the tronies tend to take on their own life that's out of my control, which is exciting. So, yeah. And that is something that you can't do with portraiture either, which is, I don't know, it's pretty liberating to be able to paint from a photograph and not worry if it doesn't look like the person that you've set out to paint, but it's a different story when, it's a different story with portraiture. You have to be sort of, you have to capture a likeness and a sense of the person that you're painting. And I just thought I'd put in a slide of the painter Michael Barmans, who's a contemporary Belgian painter. He also paints in the Troné genre, one of the very few other painters who do. And he paints all of his pictures from photographs, and he also makes photographs, film stills, drawings, sort of old vintage advertisements, and as you can see, his painting is very evocative and has that beautiful sort of still and European style, a huge emphasis on sort of lighting and shadow. So, thought I'd follow that up with talking about the Archibald, just because portraiture is quite different from painting trainings. So, this is a photo from the opening night, which was great. This is my painting of the local singer-songwriter Dane Taylor, who lives in Thule, and he lived in Australia when I met him. But he's in Thule now. And he's the lead singer of Shiny Bird, who just released their second album at the end of last year called Black Opal. I decided that I wanted to paint Dane for the Archibald at the beginning of 2015. And it took four attempts to get the painting that I wanted. So four attempts over 2 years. Just before the Archibald last year, I did this because I felt happy with it. I wanted to paint Dane as simply as possible, almost as a silhouette figure, just to illuminate his main features, which are his beard and his eyes and his eyebrows, and to also get like an overall sense of his broodiness. Like, before I met him, I was a waitress in a cafe for a while, and he and his band used to come in a lot, but I was always too scared to talk to them, particularly him, because he is like very intense and like brooding and mysterious. Once I got to know him and drew him a couple of times and ended up with his painting, he's not like that at all. He's a very nice person. So another important part of this painting is the symbolism of the picture in the background, which is actually a motif also taken from sort of small painting in the Netherlands from the 17th century. This painting actually references a famous painting by Rupert Bunny, who is a significant sort of Australian artist in the beginning of the 20th, or end of the 19th, beginning of 20th century. He painted a lot of Australian landscapes and then went over to France during his very early career and sort of developed a brand new sort of light, airy, romantic style. So the painting in the background is an appropriation of one of his paintings with sea nymphs in it. And I can't remember the name of that painting, which is really bad. Sea Idol, the Sea Idol. Thanks, Mark. Oh. Alright, so this is a painting that I did a couple of months before Dane Taylor paint portrait, and it also features the same sort of painting motif in the background. So in 17th century figurative painting in the Netherlands, in interior paintings, they featured paintings in their paintings to symbolise sort of the emotional state of people in the picture. So a stormy sea meant emotional turbulence, or a calm sea meant like everything was good and still and lovely. And in this painting, it's like I wanted to do a calm sea with a stormy sky, so like everything's perfect, but then it's not going to be perfect forever. And I also kind of wanted to do that with Dane's portrait as well, because as I got to know him, I realised that he's kind of like me. He thinks, overthinks everything, and he's kind of at war with his own creativity. So I kind of wanted to allude to that in a subtle way with this painting, making a bit stormy. And I'll just finish up now by talking about my current work. I recently had an exhibition at the Egg and Dart show. It actually closed today. And the show is called Domestica. It featured my tronies and also some still life paintings as well. I tried still life painting at the beginning of my studies at ANU, but didn't really take to it very well. I didn't really engage with it too much. Found it a bit boring. And it's kind of rigid as well, because I thought that you had to depict everything as it was, which turns out that you don't have to. And later on in studies, I sort of fell in love with the work of Giorgio Moroni, who's a beautiful Italian still life painter. And he saw the abstraction in real life, everyday situations. So I sort of began to see reality in that way as well. I changed my approach to still life painting. For domestic, I did several paintings of teacups, and they're kind of symbolic to me of a very feminine kind of domestic interior existence that I sort of grew up idolizing. Or not idolizing, romanticizing. I didn't really want it, but I thought that it was kind of cool. And I guess these paintings feature the repetition of these teacups, which kind of sort of, I guess, also symbolizes the mundanity of everyday life, the repetition of routines and thoughts and little practices and habits. Even though something really beautiful can be great, I think if you sort of overdo it, it can become boring or not special anymore. So I kind of wanted to find a way to talk about that. And I'll continue to do so in future works. But this is the installation shot from the exhibition at Egg and Dart, which was great. And yeah.
That's it for my presentation today. Thank you. So this is India and myself at the Archibald Luncheon on the day here, 14th of July 2016. And I also got to meet Dane, who was a lovely man, and yeah, it was very exciting, and here we are almost a year later. So to wind right back, I was born in Brunswick, Georgia. That's me. Just put that on the slide. Yeah, so this is the birth certificate that I have. It's a merit certificate for my mother. in vast difference to what we get in Australia, which is very mundane. For those of you who aren't mothers, it's a very boring letter. This one's got a big shiny gold sticker on it to say, good job. And that's me, the little baby. So I was born to an American father and Australian mother. He's even got the bubblegum shrimp company shirt on because I was born in Brunswick, Georgia in the south. But that marriage didn't last long and I moved to Australia when I was 2 years old. That's in Kangaroo Valley, I'm with my mum. Okay, so I looked everywhere for a photo of me drawing or painting. I couldn't find one, so I put a photo of me holding a big instead. I have a memory of this as being a packet of Smarties, but when I found the photo, it was different. I don't know why I'm holding a beer can, I promise I didn't start drinking that early. So I did find some pictures though. This, I don't know when I did this. This, I have no idea, but it's a little texture drawing I did. And I found it very fascinating that I've got two suns, two clouds, a male and a female, and everybody's super happy. So that must have meant that my childhood was pretty happy, I have to say. Everyone is so extremely happy and very comfortable. Now, I found this letter to Santa, and once again, I've got Santa and Mrs. Claus, so I must have been a feminist back then. I've always got male and female. And every word is a different colour. So I must have been obsessed with colour from a young age, and as you can see, I still am. Then I went to high school. I've actually got one of my high school teachers here, Mr. Davis, which is wonderful. This was a drawing I did, I think, around year 8, a painting, sorry. I never classified myself as a portrait artist, but as you see and as I've discovered, I paint a lot of faces. This is actually a painting of some stonework from somewhere. I have no idea, I don't have the memory. But it was some type of stonework of Neptune or something like that. And here is some type of repetitive pattern that we did, I think, in maybe year 9, but you can start to see that graphic design and pop art started to become an influence in my life. Now this painting I did about year 10 or year 11, this isn't a finished painting, I apologise for the quality, because this is a dodgy photocopy of a photo, and it was a partial finished painting that I never ever got a final photo of, the final work, because it was submitted into the Young Portuguese when I was that age, and it was stolen from the show. So I never found it, never saw it again. And yeah, all my family and friends have these wonderful ideas about it being turning up one day. But the final work had all those faces were all interwoven with the strands of hair, like surreal style. And the symbolism of this work was that the faces on this side, my stepdad, my mum, my brother, my sister, and my biological father, my grandfather and grandmother, they're the US side and the Australian side. The light is on the Australian side, so I know them. And in the dark was the US family. And it was about learning to know who you are and where you come from. So it was quite symbolic at that young age, and that's carried through. And once again, I didn't classify myself as a portrait artist, but was doing what? What's that? 7, 8 faces in one painting. So this was my year 12 work. This was sculpture. Who would have thought I did sculpture? Paper mache. Once again, faces. And this was age 27. Back in 95. So I'll show you this video. She's like, oh, is that the 27 Club? Which everybody knows about now. It's about a lot of musicians who died at the age of 27. And then there's people that have been added to this list, like Amy Winehouse, and this one's Kurt Cobain, Jimi Hendrix and Janis Joplin. And at the time I was also going to do Jim Morrison and Brian Jones from the Rolling Stones. But there is a list this long of artists that have died at the age of 27, peak their career, often drug use or suicide. And this work was all about that. But I stumbled across this idea at the time. No internet, mind you. It was just something, I was into music and I discovered that. And did this work about. And parallel to India, I also, it's an artist piece. 1995, were you born?
There you go, she's 2 years old.
So, yes, I got into Art Express as well, so we do have those parallels there. That's very chuck. Those sculptures sit dusty and falling apart in my garage right now. So I went to uni and I got a haircut too. Must be a rite of passage for women to go and get their hair chopped off when they go to uni. This was the first, oh no, this, I guess I did that on self-portrait. So this was a self-portrait that I did at uni. You can see there, 97. And yeah, I guess it was playing with front on and three-quarter face or something like that. But I actually went to uni for graphic design. So unlike India, who you decided that you were going to pursue arts after the Art Express, for some reason I got it in my head that you could never make a living as an artist, be sensible and get a trade. So I went to uni and got a graphic design degree. But I love drawing. This was a doodle in one of my notepads, like the front page of one of my art diaries or something. I actually didn't want to give up the painting, so I convinced the lecturers that I could do a painting component of the degree without going to any lectures or any classes. Just hand me the assignment and I'll hand it in one time. And still go to my graphic design classes. So I actually did my final work on the stack, which this has actually got an interesting story. But these were some paintings that I did as a drawing. And this was all back 99, so way before the stack was even of interest to anybody. Now, the final work that I did for my degree was this one. It's Can't Be Sick, Invisible Girl on Rocky Bars. I think that's Bookember Primary School or something that's in the shadows of the stack. And this, at the time, was all neon clouds at sunset. And this big, tall painting, it's huge. I did and got my degree on that. Now this painting was too big to hold on to when my mum moved and I moved out of home. So my mum donated it to the museum at Port Kembla, there's a firehouse museum or something. Anyway, that closed down and this painting went missing. Not missing, but we couldn't track it, didn't know where it was. One day mum's looking through Mercury and there's a picture of somebody and in the background was my painting. I was like, oh, it's still there, years later. So I didn't really care. I was like, oh, that's interesting. Anyway, mum was shopping in Port Kembla in one of the boutiques and was telling the lady behind the counter about this because my mum finds it fascinating. And she said, oh, you don't mean the painting that's in the business chamber. And mum's like, what do you mean? So she walked around and sure enough, there was my painting. And she met Ian Fulford, who at the time was the director of the Port Kembla Business Chamber, and he has been searching high and low for the artist who painted this painting because I never signed it. And mum's like, that's my daughter! So anyway, we arranged this. This was like 2013. So 10 years after I painted it, I was called in and signed it finally, and he was so thrilled, and since then, I don't think he's the director anymore, he's got dementia and he's had to move on, but it's gone to a doctor's surgery and it keeps floating around. I keep getting emails saying, we've got your painting, it's safe, are you okay with it being? I'm like, yeah, look after it, it's huge, I can't look after it myself. So that's a funny little story about the stack. Then, not a year later, it was demolished. So I entered the Postcodes exhibition here at Wollongong Art Gallery with this painting. So it's almost come full circle. Now this is called The Felling. And as you can see in the glasses at the top, it's this stack coming down. And this painting was representative of the emotions and the conversations that were around the stack coming down. Some people were happy, some people were sad, some people filled with nostalgia or hope, because there was a project or an alliance trying to get that stack turned into a tourist attraction at the time. So that's the end of that argument. You know, some of the kids thought it was just like Hollywood and other people just would, my mum was devastated. So there was all sorts of emotions around that. And I just thought that was an interesting story. So I've gone off on a tangent back to uni. I did graduate, so that's me, looking young and fresh. And my hair's grown back a bit. But after uni, I went and worked in a graphic design studio. And focused on that, didn't paint for years and years and years. Instead, I
focused on having, getting married and having children. So this one, the red shirt bow, I asked him if he wanted to come today and hear Mum talk about her life. And he said, "Mum, I already know, I am your life." So while I was on maternity leave, I had a bit of time. I'm a very busy person, I can't sit still. So I had a bit of time, so I thought, what can I do? I'm going to paint again. I haven't painted in 10 years. So I started working on some of these children's paintings, which were for my kids' rooms to start with, and then people would tell me, oh, you should sell them at the markets. So I started painting them. And I actually sold quite a few, so there's probably a lot of people who have got these types of works in their kids' rooms. Because I painted these for a couple of years and sold them at the kind of markets, cold art markets, anywhere you can see, probably quite thingy. And then, one of the guys I work with, his close friend, his wife's up the back here, he turned around and said, you know what, I'd like you to paint a picture of my daughter. And she's up the back as well. And this is Rose, just three at the time. And that took my breath away. I was like, what? Want me to paint a picture of a person? Like a realistic portrait? I paint animals. I'm not an artist, I'm an illustrator. And he said, no, you can do it, fine. So I had that picture, and I sat on that for 3 years. And I stressed about it, and I was anxious, and I think I started a little way about 10 times. And every time I started working with him full time, I'd say, oh, Scott, I'm going to work on it, I promise. He's like, it's okay. Meanwhile, Rose turned 4, 5, 6. And then I read a book, and this book was about your path, and the right path, and what people are destined to do. And it really opened my eyes, and it made me think, you're meant to be a painter. And I got up, clicked with me, and I woke up 6 o'clock on a Sunday, which is unusual for me. And I started painting, and I got the painting done in one day. And that's it. So I, at the time, was so anxious about giving it to Scott. I was like, oh, he's going to hate it. I butchered his little beautiful daughter. But he did. He loved it. And the praise that I got from his very first portrait, first time I painted a portrait, by this stage it's 13 years, gave me the confidence to move forward. So I thought, okay, well, if I can do that, I can paint portraits of my own family. I'd had a blank wall in our lounge room that needed work on it. So I started painting my family. Now, graphic design background, mind you, 10 years in the industry. I decided to work with a new style. Right? This is my youngest one, he was 2 at the time. And I thought, I'm going to do like poster style portraits using, and this sort of care soap book. Integrate that into it and tell a bit about his real cheeky personality. So Jack is in the style of the pear soap writer, not necessarily that one, I looked at a lot of posters. 100% pure soap on one of the posters. I turned him into cheeky. Australian made, he was born in Australia, and established 2010, his birthday. Then next one was Bo, who is a daydreamer, so I decided to do him as like a space cadet. And this is the exact poster that I used as a reference material. You can see that robot is appearing in the poster. That teddy bear is a teddy bear he's had since birth and still loves. He's 10 years old now. But the fonts and everything like that were all things that I looked at with this sort of Russian propaganda style posters, and highly influenced by that. Then I did one of my husband. So these were all the same colour palettes as well, so I wanted them to all be side by side. And I said to him, he loves beer and he loves golf. And I said, what do you want me to do, beer or golf? And he said, oh, I'll do beer. So I looked at these old Budweiser posters, and you can obviously see the influence. Here in the tap is Ritchie, brewed 1973. So that's his birthday and surname and things like that. Changed the popcorn into peanuts because I could draw peanuts better than popcorn. And then myself, which for me, this theme of juggling act or balancing act, things like that, is a running theme through a lot of my work, being a working mother, trying to do it all, trying to have it all. And obviously it's influenced by circus, the circus theme. There's a lot of symbolism in my work. With this one, the bite out of one of the apples is representative of Apple Macintosh computers. Because because of being a graphic designer, that's all we have, you know, all we have ever have is, and without the Apple Mac, I wouldn't have a career. So there's a lot of apples with white taken out of them in my work. There's also, it's hard to see, but there's bees in there as well, which Melissa means honeybee. So yeah, you can see there that, and all the names were big up top because it was purely meant for our country. I never ever meant to have this work seen anywhere else, and I was just going to sit on that and get on with my life. At the time, a friend of mine had been put a call out for the International Women's Day exhibition, and I had no confidence. I thought, these are terrible, by the way. And I was like, oh, I wonder if that work would suit, because it was on par with International Women's Day. So I showed her, and she's like, yeah, bring it in. So I brought it in. So the Art Arena Gallery around the corner here. And at the time, I was like, you've got to have an exhibition. I've never shown before. I knew nothing about art. I didn't know anybody in the art community in Wollongong. And I was like, oh, okay. And they're like, you're going to have an exhibition this year? I said, I've only got four paintings. That's cool. So, these four here, that's all I had. And I was like, oh my God, I'm going to paint. I've worked full time. I've got two young children. So I set to work. The exhibition, I coined this term posters, which is pop art poster portrait. Mouthful, but I do think my work's pop art. And then I just contacted everyone in my family to see who would like to be painted. And painted my butt off. I worked from 8:30 to midnight most nights, and while I was doing this, I had my work up on Facebook and things like that. And this was a series called Colouring Your Life, and Graham Stevenson found me online and called me up one day and said, would you like to be one of the featured artists? It's a half an hour series. At the time it was just national, but now it's gone international. It's in Europe, it's in America, it's everywhere, it's online as well. So they did a little segment about me, and at the time he said, you were the greenest artist we've had on here. He knew that I knew nothing, but I was just trying my best. So, that was the thing. And I have, did you see all the work? Did that come up? There it is, okay. So yeah, I painted these paintings. I painted two a week. So I was just working so hard. In there I've got the badass is my brother, Ray Sunshine's my husband's grandfather, Songbird's a cousin, Wonder Mother's another cousin, then we've got Mum and my stepdad, and Del Macho's Wendy Sailor. Somebody said to me, you've got to get some celebrities in there. So I started contacting some local celebrities. Glenn Saville, the basketball, was the first one to say yes. Then Wendell Sailor said yes. Gary Emson, Angry Emson, was campaigning at the time for the seat of Throsby, which I live in. So he was willing to do anything, and that was great. But I painted something like 20 odd paintings and just worked so hard to get this exhibition together. So we had the exhibition, and my painting was sold by Ken from Mason Water. You might see it in his gallery. My painting's on the wall at home. I've got two sons, a dad, and now the grandparents, because my painting never was replaced. That was something that I'd really moved a long way in a very short period of time. It was a bit of a whirlwind for me. Completely self-taught, uneducated when it comes to art. I just did what I just tried my best. And all of this was acrylic painting, by the way. I just did my best. I'd actually ask leaders for advice. Bill of Leaders, what do you think about this? Do you know? You just give me advice. So I had some commissions out of it. People contacted me and saying, I want to be one of your poster portraits. So the first one was Norman Reese. I'm not sure if you know him. He's head of the Elroy Ambos. But all of the symbolism in that painting represent elements of his life. And he didn't know what he wanted at the time. He said, oh, I don't know. You come up with an idea. He's been a security guard, an ambulance driver. He's done all sorts of stuff. All in that Japanese,
parts, which is a jack of all trades type thing, is all symbolism. It's been undertaken and everything. There's all symbolism for all the things that he's done and the highlights of his life. So he's been like security for the Wiggles and Muhammad Ali and all sorts of stuff. So if you have a look at all the details, you'll see all that. Also, the gargoyles on the end of the swords, they're actually at the front of his house. And everyone knows his house on the street. He's got these quirky gargoyles on his fence post. Super Mario, this was a man named Mario, who he had all the ideas. He came to me and said, I want this, 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 this. I want bubbles with my wife and my sons and their wives. And I want all the coins from the game to be footballs and volleyballs and all this sort of stuff. So I just did what he asked and came up with that. And then Wilson Gold, that's actually my boss, his wife commissioned that for a surprise 60th present. And he's obviously a golfer.